Dear brother, affectionate brother, Justice Sahai, other judges, ministers, the inevitable Jayaprakash, who punctuates every speech with his own summary and adds to the time which is very short. Friends and comrades, I am aware that this session is supposed to stop at 12:30. I am also aware that the procession of speakers could not have been curtailed for obvious reasons. The only contribution I can make is to inflict brevity upon my own speech and say that I wish you well, especially because the theme is absolutely urgent in the context of the world today. Even so, a few words. A few words only. Mr. Justice Sahai referred to the Supreme Court and its problems, the Allahabad High Court and its problems, and they are real. Our country is a large one. Our population is staggeringly colossal. Our disputes are mounting day after day, and resolution of conflicts, unless promptly achieved, may lead to more conflicts, more violence, and more social dissensions. Similarly, reference was made to environment. The environment in this country is highly polluted. Delhi, the capital city, is competing with the capitals of the world and the big cities of the world to become the most polluted city of the world. This is the external pollution. But the country itself is competing with the rest of the world for lack of internal purity. Without internal purity, external purity is just impossible. We have been told about gender injustice. Women are being discriminated against, and that should stop. We have been also told about human rights and the values which we must nurture and culture if a better consciousness is to improve this world where we live. Nevertheless, the theme of this conference, you must be reminded, has a cosmic dimension. It is not to make the values for a better India. It is not merely a conference on human rights as obtaining in this country, or their violation and how to prevent it. We are taking a perspective which is global in character, universal in its dimensions, and totally cosmic, that is much beyond the universe. What is the role of spiritual values in raising the level of material consciousness of man, woman, and child? Until we come to the conclusion that spirituality is the essence of material progress and pursuit of happiness, all that we are doing is only aggravating the madness of mankind. Are we able to understand this proposition? If you disagree, please disagree and go. If you agree that it is the spiritual values that sustain a society, that a social order can work only if there is a spiritual order, that the values which will improve and give us a better world are precisely those values which are selfless values, which look kindly at the neighbor, which have compassion for all living creatures, which really takes us to what has been described in the meditational interval as the Supreme, that is Shiva Baba and his human instrument for a time, and the messenger, Prajapita Brahma. You may agree with Shiva Baba and you may say it is Allah. You may not agree with Prajapita Brahma, you may say it is Vivekananda or Ramakrishna. The issue is not that. You may not agree with the details of the theology or even the technology of meditation. But do you agree that we are more than this body? Do you agree that we are more than all the glory that we see in this worldliness? Do you agree that mere affluent consumerism does not make you produce real happiness for you? Do you really see that there is a soul within, that there is a divinity within, that it is the realization and awareness of that divinity which is in every creature that can make for a better world? Sans this realization of divinity in everyone, sans the recognition that we can have fullness of life only by making a journey from this internal being to the Supreme Being, we cannot conceive of a better world. The Second World War came and left, the Third World War will come and go, the Fourth World War will come, the Stone Age will come, and there will be annihilation's waste. We need not discuss about that. Our task now is, can we produce a better world? Should we not produce a better world? And if we are to produce a better world, what does it mean? Not better, a more handsome wife, more gold ornaments for her, my children going to America in Harvard University and getting dollars upon dollars and then coming back home with so many presents for people here because she's coming from a glorious country to a pauperized country. Is that the better world that you have in mind? Or you have family happiness, people living together in peace, security for everyone, no terrorism, this world harmony. This is the aim, a harmonious human relationship prevailing, providing each family, each individual with happiness. Is that the goal? Indeed, after the Second World War, when the United Nations Charter was drafted, the emphasis was by the leaders of the earth, the emphasis was upon the dignity of the individual and the worth of the human person. A world which will have peace and will abolish the scourge of war. These were the primary purposes achieved by the consciousness of the world community and its leaders when the World War ended and they formed the United Nations and drew up a charter. So the dignity of the individual, a value for a better world. The worth of the human person, that there is what is called a person, not the shirt, not the three-piece suit, not the robes that I wore, nor the other appendages which make me look more attractive or make me pleasurable, the craze for pleasures, not that. The worth of the human person, the dignity of the individual, peace in society, and the scourge of war being abolished. Just take these four values. This great institution organized a few years ago millions of minutes of peace. Everyone in this world to spend 1 minute meditating on peace, let there be peace, there shall be peace. Why? Because we want to abolish war. War means bloodshed, blood and tears. We do not want a war with blood and tears. We want sisterhood and brotherhood of humanity. That is the joy that this cosmos must enjoy if we are to have a better world. What are these values being clear? These are irrefutable values, as I said. Dignity. Dignity of the individual means the recognition of the divinity in me. I have godliness within. The Christians said, Christ said, thy kingdom come, the kingdom of God is within you. The Advaita philosophy said, and Vivekananda said, there is divinity in each one. In fact, he said, religion is the manifestation of the divinity in every man. So the dignity of man is a material word, a phrase used to express the more profound idea of divinity of man. When I see a Muslim, I say, there is divinity in you. I cannot hate you because there is divinity in you. When I see a Christian, I say, there is divinity in you. I cannot hate you. When I see a man who spits on me, I say, you may spit because of your own misunderstanding of what you are. There is divinity in you. Your spitting is really because of misunderstanding of what you are. Refine your soul. I am a soul. This conception of I am a soul, but then this soul is encased in a body. But body is not the reality, the soul is the reality. When I do a good judgment in court, it is not because I want fame, but because I want to wipe every tear from every eye. What is behind every eye being, every tear being wiped from every eye? Because that person's suffering is my suffering. God commands me, wipe out his tear. Love him. Treat him as your brother. Treat her as your sister. Then alone we can have a world, a better world of higher values. It is a chase for pursuit of higher values. But what are we having today? Affluent consumerism. Your bhoga not tyaga. Used to be written here, my eyesight is poor. It is not bhoga that we want. What we now have is chase for bhoga. Yesterday I read in the newspapers the discussion in parliament. Fast food must be stopped. What is this fast food? This is pleasure. Fast food is not merely food. It is symbolic of all the vulgar pleasures that man and woman are crazy about. We want to be free, and you can never be free so long as you are overridden by the bondage of pleasures, vulgar pleasures, sex pleasures, and other pleasures, and ostentation, and ego mentioned there. Ego is at the root of all this. Ego, jealousy. I must become the Chief Justice. I must become the Chairman of the Law Commission. I must become the Chief Minister. I must become the Prime Minister. I must become the Rashtrapati. I must become this, that, and the other. And I must have all the palaces which belong to me. Although I might have cheated people, deceived people out of scam and built those palaces, but I must sit in the palace and other people must come and see and envy me. If this is what you want, you are not for a better world, you are for a vulgar world. That is why I insist that this conference is really geared to awakening the soul within, geared to making you realize that this fossil body, while it is necessary that you keep your body clean, you must have, if you have dirt on your body, you must make it clean. Go to a Brahma Kumari center, you will get the cleanest food ever. I have always been telling them the best propaganda that you can do for the Brahma Kumari institution all over the world is whatever they give you to eat, it is the purest food. Because food matters. You may want food to keep this body alive, but that food must be pure. Not carnivorous food, not alcoholic food. In fact, many people have liquid dinner before the regular dinner begins. Now, it is not that. What we want is not smoke, not the pipe. Then you get cancer. Your body becomes impure. It creates problems for you. It creates problems for hospitals. It creates problems for humanity. But realize that there is a body, and that body has to be kept clean, kept healthy, because in that body there is the soul. I am really the soul. There is that light burning. We can light, lit several candles today here. One candle can dispel the darkness of the entire world, provided that candle is kept burning. So it is my duty to see that this candle is lit. And this candle is lit perpetually oiled. How? By constant communion with an eternal power, a spiritual, supreme spiritual power. It is this linkage. The value nexus is between the individual soul, which is burning candle, the light within, and my contact constantly, always, whatever I may do. I may be speaking, but I am thinking, there is a supreme power. I am part of that power. I must have a link with that power. It is that nexus which will charge my battery. Not oratory, but charging the battery is a different device. Can we approach the problem from that angle? Then you come to understand whether Shiva Baba, what is meant by Shiva Baba? Shiva is Shivam, Satyam, Sundaram. We always speak of Satyam, Shivam, Sundaram. All religions of the world, and even Marxism, without any religion, in the ordinary sense, they always feel that humanity's happiness must be there, in its purest sense. And be your religion what it may, you accept the fact that there is a selfless being within you, that is the soul. And once you accept that fact, then how are you going to keep that soul pure? The purity of the soul can be preserved by rejecting pollution, external and internal. This world is so full of pollution. The Supreme Court is charged with the task. The other day I read, the Supreme Court of India has directed 8,000 odd polluting units in the Delhi city to be removed. Why? Not because they are against industries, but they are against pollution. They are concerned at the moment with the external pollution. The desire to drive out external pollution comes because they are against internal pollution. The man who pollutes and makes profit is really vulgar. He wants money. He doesn't care for the neighbor's health. But the Supreme Court says no. India must be clean. Indian air must be pure. Indian atmosphere must be preserved. Indian biosphere is something which is invaluable. Therefore, we of the Supreme Court direct that those who pollute the biosphere shall go out of Delhi and not pollute the entire atmosphere where people have got to breathe and live a healthy life. That instinct comes. This urgency, the urge to do justice, is a spiritual urge. That is because the judges have realized, whether they have openly said so or not, that there is a soul within. I see the Supreme Court of India and the High Courts of India as spiritual institutions only. Secularly performing what really the spiritual instinct in them compels them to do. Understand that beneath and internally, the judges function, or the ministers function for that matter. Why do you speak only of the judges, the ministers and the lawyers, the chartered accountants, in whose hands the purity of companies is vested, the secretaries of companies? It is their profession is not merely to look into the balance of whether they have been kept correctly or not, but then to see that there is a spiritual purity in the operation of the corporations. So everywhere you see this importance of the soul within. And that soul is not my individual property. It shares with all of you. Each one of us has the same. And each one of us is bound to each other through one constant star. And that star we call Shiva Baba. You call by any other name, doesn't matter. Recognize. It is this, the theme which makes this conference unique. We talk of jurisprudence. We talk of human rights. Human rights are human rights because you recognize the right to be human. We are discussing here human rights. Why human rights? Why not animal rights? Why not worm rights? Why not other lower creatures and their rights? We are discussing human rights because within the human being, there is a certain dignity and divinity, and from that we postulate the rights of the humans. The right to be human is recognized. That is why we call it human rights. And the right to be human is the right to be divine. The same thing. We have to realize this aspect of the right to be human as equivalent to the right to be divine. It is the divinity that you touch when you really ravish a woman or rape her. What you are doing is, you are violating her dignity, violating the reverence that you owe to the divinity of a woman. And that means you are violating the divinity of all mankind, all humanity. You are not violating one woman. By doing that act, you are violating the divinity of all. I am wounded when a woman is raped. That's why I said, in one of my judgments, maybe many people will disagree with me, when a man at the dawn is hanged by a death sentence, the flag of humanity dips low that hour, because one human being has been hanged. One human being has his soul eclipsed. His body is gone, but I believe in life after death. So for my mind, to my mind, it doesn't affect me much, but I do feel that justice is really divinity in action. Justice is divinity in action. That is why even the American judges have said, law is the means, justice is the end. What is the end? The creation of a social order. The Indian Constitution under Article 38 speaks of a social order. Read the Indian Constitution, section Article 38. It speaks of a social order which abolishes inequality, which abolishes disabilities, which confers upon everybody the basic needs which he requires or she requires for a happy life. And that social order is only an expression of a spiritual order which enlivens the social order. Enlivening the social order is the spiritual order. And this cannot be done by one person. It can be done not by a king, not by the ballot box, but it can be done only by an awakening from within. And that awakening from within must be charged constantly, otherwise it becomes decadent. And charging means communion. There must be a resource which is infinite. It is that infinite resource that the Brahma Kumari is called Shiva Baba. It is that infinite resource which communicates to you and did originate the whole process, the Prajapita Brahma. What I say is, nomenclature apart, we must accept the fact that there is the reality of a soul, and moreover, that the body is not really what matters. And therefore, you should reject the idea of running after pleasures, craze for pleasures. This country for me, this country of religions, this world which has suffered two world wars, today is suffering with so many local wars. People are killing each other. Brother killing brother. Sisters dying. But nobody is bothered because our soul has been anesthetized. Nothing affects you. I want, therefore, a quickening of your conscience. And that can be possible only by this new jurisprudence, which I once In my first address to the in the Gandhi Memorial lecture delivered in 1976 in Delhi, the Gandhi Peace Foundation asked me to deliver it. There I called it jurisconscience. Jurisprudence, when it is when its purpose is to transform the social order, becomes jurisconscience, because you conscientize yourself. And that conscientization process is what they have now told you through meditation. Meditate, contemplate, reflect, realize. And then you begin on the journey to a higher jurisprudence. Namaste.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.